actually going to do a little bit of a rant on things I feel like photographers need to stop doing if you want to be successful in the wedding industry, in the photography industry. And it's going to be kind of a tough love video, but I don't want it to be mean. I don't want you to hate me after, because I'm going to call you out. I say this because I'm actually calling also my younger self out from things that I did and I see people doing all the time. And I don't say it to be mean, I'm just saying the things that I feel from personal experience and things that I've learned that have actually hindered my success. And if you relate to any of them, I just feel like it will bring you more awareness to the fact that that may be something that's hindering your success too, so. So the first thing I feel like people do in this industry that is holding back their success is that we all have people in the wedding space, in the photography space that we look up to, right? They've been in the industry for 10 years. They have gone to a place where they're charging so much money for weddings. They're killing it. They're fully booked, whatever. And I feel like people don't realize, number one, that it took them 10, 15 years. It takes 10, 15 years to kill it in this photography industry. And what comes along with that is 10 years of the industry changing. So I feel like what happens is, and what I am guilty of as well, is you idolize these people who have reached this goal that you want to reach. So for example, charging $20,000. My kitty's here. Charging $20,000 or booking weddings in Italy. They've reached that goal. And because they've reached that goal, we are idolizing them because they've reached that, you know, they've gotten there. And because of that, we assume that that business model that they are using works. And when in reality, that business model that they are using maybe worked for them to move them forward 5 years ago or 7 years ago, and then whatever they were doing then worked a little bit more and worked a little bit more. But today, if I were to start doing what they were doing 5 to 7 years ago, it might not work because the industry is different. So, simple example is Instagram, right? Instagram was not nearly as big as it was 10 years ago. That's both an advantage and something to be aware of, because the people that I idolize in this industry are not that active on Instagram, and it is because they don't have to be. So if I were someone who was like, such and such isn't even posting every day and they book weddings at $15,000 and they do all these things, and this person I idolize doesn't even do this on Instagram, they don't have to, because they grew at a different speed and a different time than you and I. So I just feel like a lot of people, we idolize these people, and it is true, and what they've done is hard work, and it's taken a lifetime for them to establish their legacy. But never forget that the industry is changing week to week, month to month. A pandemic happened, and you have to pivot and be self-aware of where you are in this industry. And TikTok, like things like TikTok, Clubhouse, all of that is great marketing tools that a lot of our industry top people are not monopolizing on, simply because they don't have to, which doesn't mean that we shouldn't, and it doesn't mean that we don't have to either. So kind of to summarize this, I feel like people often idolize business models that were successful but are now outdated. And since you want to like mimic people you idolize's behavior, you don't try things, or you just do what they say, and it might not work for you because that's not the industry that we're in at this moment. Like I said, that's why I am hesitant to, I've never had an actual photography mentor, and I have actually learned the most from building my business from people who are one or two steps ahead of me, not 10. And that goes to kind of what I just explained. Like, they were at my phase in my level of business not that long ago, and they moved up not that long ago. And so how did they do that? Not that, you know, recently. So when it comes to mentors, I don't think anyone needs a photography mentor. And I think a photography mentor who has done what you want to do so long ago, everyone can always add value. I'm not saying that, oh, they don't mean it. What they're saying doesn't mean anything. Everybody adds value, no matter what stage you're in, and all of that. I respect that success so much. But when it comes to what's directly applicable to me and my business, it's always been the people who are killing it, you know, on Instagram Reels, and people who are just got onto TikTok. And I'm like, oh my God, did you just book a wedding on TikTok? You just started this? Like, this is new. How'd you do that? So it's the people, it's more my friends who I know are a little farther than me that I actually learn the most applicable and get the most tools to actually move my business forward from. And also, there's this quote by Marie Forleo when it comes to education. Like, I'm like 23 and I'm in here talking about wedding photography education. Why do I think I can do this? Because she said in her book once, you only need a 10% edge. So I only need to be 10% farther than you to tell you how I got that 10% farther. So I don't feel like, oh, I'm not experienced enough to talk about this, because I'm learning from people who are just one step farther. And then I feel like there are people who are one step lower, and I can bring you one step farther. So, okay, the next thing I feel like I'm guilty of, a lot of people are guilty of, and no one is like talking about it. You go onto a photographer's website, or you hear a podcast, Instagram, whatever, and you look at how much they're charging, and then you in your head define how much they're worth based on how much they're charging. And I just need everyone to stop doing that, including myself, because anyone could write anything on their website, and that's where everything gets blurry and gets messed up, when you start looking at things like that. Because you go onto a photographer's website and it says, oh, I'm charging $20,000 for a wedding, or even if $5,000 for a wedding, or whatever it is that number is, and then in your head you assume they're doing things right, you assume they're booking weddings at that rate, and you assume that this is someone to learn something from, when you actually don't know anything about this person or this business. You don't know if they're actually a doctor every day and they can charge this because they're not dependent on the income. So, you know what I mean? Like, we just don't know anything from doing that. And I think it's a behavior a lot of people do. And I don't know if it comes from this like place of like wanting to be like worthy of pricing, or self-worth, or just pure curiosity about other people. I don't know exactly where it comes from, but it is something that happens and that I've done for years, a lot of people do for years. And when I stopped doing that, I stopped caring what, I don't care what anyone is doing except for my own journey. I actually saw a lot more success and I got a lot less confused. So I just wanted to put that in here because I hope that makes sense. The next thing I feel like people do is you put yourself in a box a little bit too fast. So when it comes to photography, it's an art, you know, everyone, you know, I'm sure everyone loves photography, and you love, not everyone, but everyone on this channel, you love the art form and you loved it, and you started a business because you thought, oh, I could be really good at this, I really enjoy this. And then somewhere along the line, you realize it's a business. And somewhere along the line, you realize, oh, I need to be consistent and I need to have my editing down so that I can book people and they know who I am, and I need to stand for something and I need to have a specific style. So when you feel that pressure, and it's a real pressure and it's something that is true, a business needs to be consistent, you start making a style quickly and buying presets quickly and editing a certain way quickly and eliminating equipment, only using certain equipment quickly, and you don't spend time experimenting. And so I feel like a lot of people just quickly say, oh, I'm a bright and airy photographer, or I'm a dark and moody photographer, I'm this, without experimenting enough. And what happens when you do that is, it's great, you book weddings and you book clients and all of that, like, you know, it works, you're consistent, and then somewhere along the line you wonder what would have happened if you had experimented, and you start to go through this withdrawal creatively because you didn't let yourself experiment. You didn't experiment enough, and now you're in this box, and because you put yourself in this box, you can't get out of this box, because that would be rebranding. So I think you guys get what I'm saying, is I would just take your time with your photography style. Just because someone else is doing this and that and that, and this book's that and that, what is it that relates to you and makes you feel inspired? And that is a process that cannot be rushed. And if you rush it too fast, try to define yourself, your logo, your website, all of that too fast without experimenting on the work itself, you will lose yourself and your passion for photography. And it's harder to get it back than it is to just never have lost it in the beginning. Next mistake people make is investing in education over trying something and failing at it because you are afraid to fail. So I have been to so many workshops, so many conferences in the beginning, and I told myself, oh, if I just learn all this stuff, I'll have all this knowledge and I'll be so equipped and I won't fail because I know all this stuff, and other people don't know this stuff and they don't go to conferences, right? And I went there and I learned that there and they didn't go, so I'll have an edge on them. When education can only do so much, and like I said in the beginning, most education, in my opinion, is outdated because social media and the world is moving way too fast for anyone to have time to teach fast enough on it. Be careful of investing money in education before you have tried it yourself first. So for example, I remember this one conversation with one of my photography friends, and she was like, oh, I want to build an email list. And I was like, oh, that's great. You know, you should build an email list. And she was like, yeah, I haven't started yet, but I'm taking, you know, the Jenna Kutcher course. So Jenna Kutcher is an amazing, amazing educator in our space. And I'm taking the Jenna Kutcher course, and then I'm going to start the list. And I was like, it just hit me that, like, why do we do that? Why do we think we have to take a course before we even try something? So in my business and my learning experience, my journey, education has been the most influential when I have failed first. So when you like sign up for someone to teach you something, you're assuming that what you were gonna do wasn't gonna work, and also that what you're gonna do wasn't better than what they're doing. And it's not like a pride thing. It's not to say that, like, oh, you should think you're better than everyone. It's that you're shooting yourself in the foot every time you pay for someone to tell you how to do something when you haven't tried how to do it your way first. So I would always say trial and error. And even photographers that come to me for mentoring say, can you help me build a website or something? And I'm like, have you tried to build it yourself first? Where did you go wrong? And if you haven't tried, why are you paying me when you haven't tried it yourself first? Like, I should come in when you're stuck. So you're not stuck if you haven't tried. So that's where self-confidence, all that comes in to try. But I feel like if I had paid a little less money for people to tell me what to do and just trust in myself that I knew what I could do and what I wanted to try, I would have been felt a little bit better at my business, and maybe it would be a little bit more successful, a little bit faster. Next thing is that you might not be monopolizing on what you're good at, and that could come from you don't know what you're good at. So it takes, you know, a lifetime to figure out what your strengths are in life. And for me, I kind of always knew I wasn't a good writer. I suck at writing, and I kind of always knew I was better at talking, like YouTube and talking on camera. I just talk easier than I write, and I just am a verbal person more than whatever, you get the point. But I became aware of that strength and I used that in my business. So for example, on Instagram, there are reels, there are stories, there are photos, there are IGTV, and there are guides. Those formats that involve video and talking are the ones that I use, and the ones that involve writing and things I'm not good at, I don't use. So I think everyone has something that they are really good at, and it's just a matter of like figuring out what you're good at and using that as your strength. And I think the mistake people make is they don't know what they're good at, or they try to do things they're not good at because, again, someone in the industry told them to do this, and that is someone else's strength, but not your strength. So for example, I have a photography friend who's a really good friend of mine, and she hates being on camera. And she was like, oh, I need help making Instagram reels, but I'm a really good writer and I just suck at making things on camera. Like, I don't like it, it doesn't feel like me. And then why are you trying to do it? You're such a good writer. Why aren't you making the Instagram guides? Why aren't you blogging? Why aren't you using your writing ability? You know, why are you trying to do something that you're not good at? So that you don't like, and if you don't like it, you know, you're not going to enjoy it, and it's going to be short-lived, and you're forcing yourself to do something that you don't want to do. So if I had just like knew my strengths, I always knew my strengths, but if I had looked at my strengths and put them in my business, I think I would just be happier and just like enjoy my job more than if I just like force myself to do things that I'm not good at. So whatever you're good at, use that, and that is something that you're supposed to be using. I feel like a lot of these are like a similar theme in that you have a voice, and listen to your voice before you open your ears to other people, because I feel like that is where your power is. I hope this inspired you at least a little bit, and it wasn't like a total, I don't know, all over the place rant. Let me know in the comments if anything resonated with you. I'm actually genuinely curious. I make these videos by myself for you guys to hopefully, you know, look at them and respond to them. Otherwise, I'm just talking to the camera. So leave a comment down below. Let me know what resonates with you, what didn't, what you agree with, you don't agree with. And I come out with 2 new videos every week here on YouTube. So make sure to subscribe if you haven't already. And I will see you guys here later on YouTube.